as we read this psalm. O Lord, thou hast searched me and known me.
Thou knowest my down-sitting and mine uprising. Thou understandest my thought afar off.
Thou compassest my path and my lying down, and art acquainted with all my ways.
For there is not a word in my tongue, but lo, O Lord, thou knowest it altogether.
Thou hast beset me behind and before, and laid thine hand upon me.
Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is high, I cannot attain it.
Whether shall I go from thy spirit, or whether shall I flee from thy presence?
If I ascend up into heaven, thou art there. If I make my bed in hell, behold, thou art there.
If I take the wings of the morning, and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea,
even there shall thy hand lead me, and thy right hand shall hold me.
If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me, even the night shall be light about me.
Yea, the darkness hideth not from thee, but the night shineth as the day. The darkness and the light are both alike to thee.
For thou hast possessed my reins, and thou hast covered me in my mother's womb.
I will praise thee, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are thy works, and that my soul knoweth right well.
My substance was not hid from thee when I was made in secret and curiously wrought in the lowest parts of the earth.
Thine eyes did see my substance, yet being unperfect, and in thy book all my members were written, which in continuance were fashioned, when as yet there was none of them.
How precious also are thy thoughts unto me, O God! How great is the sum of them!
If I should count them, they are more in number than the sand. When I awake, I am still with thee.
Surely thou wilt slay the wicked, O God. Depart from me, therefore, ye bloody men.
For they speak against thee wickedly, and thine enemies take thy name in vain.
Do not I hate them, O Lord, that hate thee? And am not I grieved with those that rise up against thee?
I hate them with perfect hatred. I count them mine enemies.
Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me, and know my thoughts.
And see if there be any wicked way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting.
Shall we pray? With the psalmist, Father, we realize that you know us better than we know ourselves. There is nothing that is hid from your eyes. You know our every thought. You know the origins of the thought processes. You know when we stand up. You know when we sit down. You know what lies deep within our hearts. In that area, Lord, that we cannot even probe. With the psalmist, we recognize that such knowledge is too great for us. We cannot attain it. And so we ask you, Lord, search our hearts. Know our thoughts. Lord, see if there is something that is there that is not pleasing to you. Show it to us, that we might forsake it, and that we might follow after you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. As we continue our journey through the Bible this week, we find ourselves in the 18th chapter of Matthew. And earlier in the week, as I was preparing for this Sunday, I thought I would speak on the child text at the beginning of the chapter, the pathway to greatness. But towards the end of the week, after I had actually already given to my secretary the announcement for the message, I exercised my pastoral prerogatives and I've changed the message. And rather than talking on the pathway to greatness, that sermon will wait till some other time. I'd like to talk to you today on the subject of forgiveness. The subject was brought up by Peter in verse 21, where he came to Jesus and said, "Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother his sin against me? Seven times?" And Jesus saith unto him, "I say not unto thee until seven times, but until 70 times seven. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king which would take an account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, there was one that was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents, about $15 million. But forasmuch as he had not to pay, his Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and his children and all that he had, that payment might be made. The servant therefore fell down and worshipped him, saying, 'Lord, have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion, and he loosed him, and he forgave him his debt. But the same servant went out. He found one of his fellow servants which owed him 100 pence, about $15. And he laid his hands on him and took him by the throat and said, 'Pay me what thou owest.' And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and begged him, saying, 'Have patience with me, and I will pay you all.' And he would not, but he went and cast him into prison until he should pay the debt. So when his fellow servants saw what was done, they were very sorry, and they came and told their lord all that was done. And then his lord, after that he had called him, said unto him, 'Oh, you wicked servant, I forgave you all that debt because you desired me to. Should you not also have had compassion on your fellow servant, even as I had pity on you?' And his Lord was angry and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. And so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you if you from your heart do not forgive every one his brother their trespass." I think that when Peter asked the question, "Lord, how often shall I forgive my brother? Till seven times?" I think that Peter in his mind was sort of stretching a bit in order to impress the Lord. I don't think that Peter really could see himself forgiving a fellow seven times for an offense against him, but yet I'll make myself look good to the Lord, and I'll stretch it a bit, and Lord, shall I forgive him seven times? Am I getting your message? Am I catching on to forgiveness, Lord? And I think he was expecting the Lord to sort of come in and say, "Yes, Peter, you're catching on now, seven times." But instead, the Lord said, "No, Peter, not seven times, 70 times seven. Ay, ay, ay." You see, the Lord was in essence saying, "Peter, forgiveness isn't a matter of mathematics. It isn't keeping count. It's losing count. Forgiveness is a matter of spirit. You're to have a spirit of forgiveness." In another place, Luke's gospel, Jesus said, "If a man trespass against you seven times in a day," same day, "and seven times in a day he turns to you and says, 'I repent,' you shall forgive him." Now, that's awfully hard for us to conceive. It tells us something about the nature of forgiveness that Jesus is talking about. It is interesting that the number 7 would be associated with forgiveness in each of the texts. You see, 7 is a symbolic number of completeness. And I think that Jesus is trying to show us that our forgiveness needs to be complete. We need to completely forgive. It's interesting that Luke tells us when Jesus said 7 times in one day, and he repents, you're to forgive, the disciples responded by saying, oh Lord, increase our faith. I think that they realized that Jesus was commanding something that was beyond their own capacity. I can't see myself doing this. I cannot do this with just my own will. Lord, increase my faith. Lord, help me. I'm not capable of attaining to that highest standard. The idea that we are to forgive others is sort of a New Testament doctrine. You don't find this in the law or in the commandments. You don't find this in the prophets of the Old Testament. In fact, in the Old Testament, there's more of a eye for an eye, tooth for a tooth. It sort of appeals to us more. That idea of getting even, getting revenge. This thought that we are to forgive is sort of introduced in the New Testament. The only place in the Old Testament I can think of, and there may be others, and if so, I'd encourage you to find them and share them with me. But there was that year of Jubilee when they were to forgive the debts and so forth. But outside of that, as far as just personal grievances, personal offenses, there's nothing that I know of in the Old Testament that says we are to forgive someone a wrong that they have done to us. But it definitely is a very major part of the teaching of Jesus. Jesus introduced the idea of man forgiving another man his offenses in the Sermon on the Mount. As he was giving to the disciples the lesson on prayer, and gave to them the model prayer, Our Father which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And there, our being forgiven was associated with our forgiving. First time in the scriptures that our being forgiven was associated with our forgiving. And then when Jesus finished that prayer, thine is the kingdom, power, and glory forever, amen, he then reemphasized the one petition. He said, for if you will not forgive men their trespasses against you, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses against him. And your being forgiven was tied with your forgiving. Now, here in the 18th chapter, again, Jesus definitely relates and ties the two together as he sort of summarizes this little story that he has given to illustrate the truth. He said, so likewise shall my heavenly Father do also unto you if you from your hearts forgive not every man or everyone his brother, their trespasses. This idea of having received forgiveness and thus forgiving is also followed up by Paul in his letter to the Ephesians. He said, be kind one to another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven you. Forgiving one another, even as God has forgiven you. Writing to the church in Colossae, Paul said, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. And if any man has a quarrel against any, forgive as Christ has forgiven you. Forgive even as Christ has forgiven you. Notice the incentive for our forgiving is that I have been forgiven. But just what does it mean to forgive? And what kind of forgiveness is it that God requires of us? And we see that it is to be the same quality, the same type of forgiveness that we have received from God. And as we look at the forgiveness that we have received from God, we realize that God's forgiveness of us is complete. God doesn't say, well, I can forgive you this and I can forgive you that, but this one, I don't see how I can forgive you that, because that was pretty deliberate. That was willful. That wasn't just a mistake. I mean, you deliberately. And so these two, but sorry, can't go this one. No, God doesn't do that to us. His forgiveness is complete. The psalmist said, who forgiveth all our iniquities. I love that. I love that. God's forgiveness of me is a complete forgiveness, not just of part of my sins, but of all of my sins. There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. He has taken all my sins and forgiven all my past. And thus, if I forgive as God has forgiven, my forgiveness must be complete. Every offense that this person may have committed against me, I can't hold back from one item. I must forgive all, or my forgiveness is not as God's forgiveness. Not only is God's forgiveness complete in that he forgives all our iniquities, but it is complete in that the issue is never brought up again. You see, so oftentimes when we forgive a person, we will even declare, well, I'll forgive you, but believe me, I won't forget. But that's not forgiveness as God forgives. Because God, when he forgives you, forgets the offense. He doesn't bring it up against you ever again. In Jeremiah 33, God promised that he would forgive their iniquities and remember their sin no more. I won't remember it. You see, to forgive without forgetting is sort of saying, well, I'll bury the hatchet, but I'll leave the handle exposed so I can grab it if ever I need it again. You know, we're so prone when a person has done something wrong and they come and say, oh, I'm so sorry, would you forgive me? Sure, I forgive you, you know. Then they do the very same thing the next day. Wait a minute. What do you mean you want me to forgive you? I forgave you yesterday. The very same thing. Now you do it again? You think I am? You know, I mean, we're remembering, you see. We're bringing up the past. How marvelous it is that God doesn't bring up that past. He buries it. In fact, the prophet Micah proclaimed, who is a God like unto thee that pardoneth iniquity and passes by the transgression of the remnant of his heritage. He retains not his anger forever because he delights in mercy. He will turn again and he will have compassion upon us. He will subdue our iniquities, and thou wilt cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. They're gone. They're erased. They're obliterated. And not erasing like sometimes on a blackboard where you just quickly rub over the blackboard with an eraser, but you can still see a little bit the faint printing inside. No, totally washed, thoroughly cleansed, forgiven. Because God's forgiveness of us is total and complete, he then requires that we forgive others totally. The forgiveness of God is so complete, it brings up another theological term, which is justification. God goes even a step beyond forgiveness. He justifies us. Now, the word justification, a big theological term, it actually means just as though you never did it. And that's just exactly how God looks at your past and your sin, your guilt. He looks at it as though it never happened. Totally exonerated. Just as though you never did it. We see in the teaching of Jesus here the importance of forgiveness. The story of the king that took an accounting, and he found a servant of his that owed him $15 million. Called him in and said, "This bill is past due. I'm going to have you and your family sold and your goods, and I want this debt paid." The fellow fell down on his knees and begged him and said, "Oh, please, don't do that. I intend to pay you, and give me a little time, and I'll try and pay you." And his Lord said, "Oh, we'll just forget it. We'll forgive you the debt." He went out, and he got a fellow servant that owed him $15. Jesus makes it very graphic. He said he took hold of him and grabbed him by the throat. I mean, you can picture, "Pay me what you owe me," you know. This. And the fellow servant said, oh, please, I don't have it yet, but payday, you know, I'll be glad to pay you payday." And he said, "No way. I've waited too long. Throw him into the debtor's prison." And had the fellow tossed into debtor's prison for this $15 debt. The other servants saw the whole thing and they came to the master. They said, "You remember that fellow that you forgave the $15 million he owed you? Do you know that he had Joe put in debtor's prison for 15 bucks? And so the Lord called him in and said, "You wicked servant. Having been forgiven so much, surely you should have forgiven your fellow servant." What Jesus is seeking to illustrate is the fact that if you look at our lives and all that God has forgiven us, look at all that God has wiped out of our sin, iniquity, and trespass. Look at how much God has forgiven us. Who am I to hold some little trivia grievance against my brother because of some little offense? "I saw him in the mall the other day and he didn't smile at me. I hate him. I'll never forgive him for that, you know. I was embarrassed when my friends, I said hi, and he just acted like I wasn't there. Oh, I'll never forgive him, you know." Like it's some big deal, you know. And yet, look how much God has forgiven me. And yet, we are holding these petty grievances against one another. Holding this bitterness. holding the anger. I'll never forgive them as long as I live, you know. They offended me. And Jesus is showing how ludicrous that is. God has forgiven us such a huge debt, and here we are holding these small debts against our brothers. The outcome, of course, is the wicked servant was to be delivered to the tormentors until the whole debt was paid. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do unto you, Jesus said. If you from your hearts do not forgive everyone his brother his trespasses. One of the greatest needs that we have is to be forgiven. You see, you'll never make it into heaven unless you have been forgiven. Sin will bar you from God's presence. Before you can really have fellowship with God, that issue of sin has to be dealt with. It must be forgiven. The Bible tells us that sin separates a man from God. God's hand is not short that he cannot save. His ear isn't heavy. He's not deaf. He can hear. But he said, your sins have separated you from God. And so for you to enter into the kingdom of heaven, it's essential that your sins are forgiven. A guilt complex is a horrible thing to have. And it creates a mental instability. Psychologists just are convinced that the majority of neurotic behavioral patterns stem from guilt complexes. I've done something I know was wrong. I feel guilty over it. I am hounded by this guilt and this sense of guilt. It doesn't seem to let go. And the guilt complex actually creates a subconscious desire for punishment. And so I may get into an accident subconsciously. It was a foolish move, but I hurt myself. I'm in pain. But that was a subconscious action on my part because I wanted to feel pain, because I felt I needed to be punished because I know I'm guilty. Or it will create a neurotic behavioral pattern. I'll start doing neurotic things, dumb things, until people turn on me and say, what's wrong with you? You're so stupid. How can you do that? And as they are punishing me, I'm feeling relieved of my guilt. Now, oh, yes, I am stupid and dumb, and thank you. I appreciate that. I needed that, you know. We need forgiveness. But it is equally important to your mental well-being that you forgive. I have a good friend who is an outstanding psychiatrist, very successful in his practice. And he operates from the basic theory that most mental problems for which people seek psychiatric help, stem from the fact that they are hanging on to a bitterness, an anger, a resentment against some person for some action against them. And this unforgiving spirit, this deep resentment in all that they have, leads them to this mentally unstable condition where they have to be placed in psychiatric care. And thus, as he deals with the patients, he seeks to probe, to discover what it is that they're hanging on to of resentment and anger and bitterness. What was done to them? Who did it to them? And he will probe until he can find the source of the bitterness that they experience. Why they're so angry, why they're so upset, why they're so tense and uptight. And when he discovers, when he can get to the issue that was really troubling them, and many times it goes way back in their childhood, he says, all right, now I want you to sit in the chair and I want you to just relax. And I want you to think about that event again. I want you to go through the event. I want you to just relive the event in your mind. See the person coming at you. Listen again to the things that they are saying. Go through that whole experience once more. And as a person is taken back and begins to relive the experiences, often they become very emotional. But when they are led through the experience once again, he'll say, all right, now stop. I want you right now to say, I forgive that person, that which they did to me. I want you to forgive them. And he leads them into a forgiveness which restores again a mental state of being well balanced. Holding on to these things, not forgiving, can plague you. It can cause you mental problems. And we are learning more and more the tie between our emotions and our physical well-being. Just this past week, a new report was released of a study that was made concerning heart attacks. And they discovered that people who have a heart disease, the heart attack usually happens within 2 hours after an outburst of anger. If you have a heart problem and you get angry, you better watch it. The next 2 hours, you're in jeopardy. And most heart attacks take place within 2 hours after a great outburst of anger. And more we're learning that feelings of bitterness, feelings of anger, feelings of resentment actually create chemicals in our bodies that are destructive to the human body. So that it is important for me physically to forgive. It's important for me emotionally to forgive. And as Jesus is teaching in the lesson, it's vital to me spiritually to forgive. If I am wanting forgiveness, which I desperately need, then I must be forgiving. Jesus is very stern about this. Forgiveness is not an option. It is not a suggestion. It is a command. I must forgive if I am expecting to be forgiven. A few years ago, I met Charles Watson, who was a part of the Manson gang and is currently in prison because of that murder spree that they went on. And I also, about the same time, met Susan, who was the daughter of the LaBiancas. When Susan came home and there was the grisly discovery of her parents who were murdered by the Manson gang and by Charles Watson, she had such hatred and such bitterness towards the persons who committed this crime against her parents, that over the years, it had begun to destroy her until the doctors told her that she had less than 6 months to live. The anger, the bitterness was eating her alive. Physically, it was destroying her. Realizing she had only 6 months to live, she wanted to get things right. You're going to be checking out. You better make sure that, you know, your reservations are all set. And so she started going to church, and she accepted Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. She heard that Charles Watson had also received Jesus Christ and was a fellow Christian. And she began to correspond with him while he was in prison. Not exposing to him her true identity. And after a few months of correspondence, she requested that she could come and visit with him there in prison. The arrangements were made with the prison officials, and Susan went and spent an afternoon with Charles there in the prison compound, in which they talked about many things, and especially about the Lord and about salvation, forgiveness. And as the time for the visit was coming to a close, she said, "Charles, I've got to square with you. My parents are the LaBiancas, the ones you killed. And I came here today to discover whether or not you were a true Christian. And I believe you are. And I want you to know, I forgive you." Charles said his response was one of just great elation. He began to weep. He felt just this heavy load going off, having been forgiven by this girl. Susan was healed. Today, she's strong, vibrant, healthy, happy, because she forgave. And that bitterness that was destroying and eating her up was released. And it was her life. It meant her life physically. It also was her life spiritually. A tremendous victory when you can let go and say, "I forgive." But there's one step even beyond. Forgiveness is, in a sense, almost a negative thing. It is the overlooking of a past wrong. I'll not really concentrate or look at that anymore. The Lord wants you to take one more step beyond forgiveness, and that is of compassion. He wants you to love. That person in your life, that event that has so damaged you and maybe has made you really unfit mentally. Maybe you can't function because of this experience that you had in your past, and it's hindering and harming you even to the present day. If you can just say, I forgive you and I love you, you'll be amazed what it'll do for you. It'll take off a heavy load, a heavy burden. It'll set you free. It will bring you new life, a new lease on life. You see, Jesus wants for you what's best for you. He knows what is harmful and destructive, and he knows that bitterness and anger are harmful. He knows that if you just forgive and if you just will love, that healing can come. And you can be a whole person. You can be a well-adjusted person. You can be a normal person by being forgiven and by forgiving. Shall we pray? Lord, you know, and we know, that this area of forgiveness is something that we just can't do in ourselves. There are some that we've wanted to forgive, we've tried to forgive, but it really isn't from our heart. We're still holding on to the resentment. And so, Lord, we need your help, and we ask your help today. Help us to do what you've required us to do. Help us to be what you want us to be. Compassionate, loving, forgiving. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Shall we stand? As David said, search me, O God, and know my heart. May that be our prayer today. God, you search me. Search out my heart. Am I holding bitterness? Am I holding resentment? Is there someone in my past that I haven't really forgiven the things, the wrongs that they have done to me? God, show me what's there. Show me what is even underneath, the things that I don't even have in my conscious level, but things that could be hindering my progress. Search me, O God, know my heart. See if there's an area of unforgiveness, and then, Lord, help me to bring it to the surface and then to bury it by forgiving. Blot it out. By forgiveness, to be freed through forgiveness. I'll tell you, it'll make a world of difference in your life when you know that you've been forgiven, and when you in turn forgive. The Lord bless thee. And keep thee. And keep thee. The Lord make his face to shine upon thee and be gracious unto thee. And be gracious unto thee. The Lord lift up his countenance upon thee.
And now, on behalf of The Word for Today, the broadcast ministry of Pastor Chuck Smith, we thank you for joining us in today's broadcast. For more of Pastor Chuck's studies and biblical teaching resources, visit our website at pastorchuck.org. You can contact The Word for Today at The Word for Today, P.O. Box 890-820, Temecula, California, 92589. Or email us at infopastorchuck@gmail.com. We'll return with more of our verse-by-verse Bible study in our next broadcast with Pastor Chuck.